We are back again. Okay. Now we have a very interesting presentation with Ingrid, who is going to speak about the dual career and the GIS program.
Okay. Can everybody hear me? Yeah? I'm okay. Well, I have a microphone, but if it's okay. If it's okay, I would like to start. So if everybody can please sit down. Well, I just arrived, so probably I didn't see everybody yet, but hi. I'm Ingrid, Ingrid van Gelder from the Dutch Olympic Committee. I work there as a program manager and responsible for the infrastructure. Hi, Tapio. That means all the training centers, the CTOs we call them, the Center of Elite Sports and Education on a national level, and also the training centers on the regional level and the regions themselves. Another part of my job is dual career. And dual career is what I will talk about today. And today I actually don't speak about the Dutch model or our Dutch work, but about a European project. It's called GoldInEducation and Elite Sports, the GIS project. And we're in a consortium of 9 countries. These are the countries involved. From every country, we have one partner from the sports perspective. So I'm from the sports perspective, and we have a university or a scientific partner as well. For the Netherlands, that's Windesheim, University of Applied Science. Actually, Spain is also in the project. Susanna is one of the partners, also from the sports side. She works for CAR. And the University of Barcelona is also a partner. But we have partners from everywhere in Europe. From the north, Sweden is involved. We have UK, Scotland, the east, Poland, Slovenia, and also France. INSEP, Victor is here as well. INSEP is doing the administrative coordination, the financial coordination. And the Free University of Brussels is responsible for the scientific part. So I think this is a really good group, 24 experts in total. And I think some of the best dual career experts in the world are in this consortium. So what we try to do with this project, we want to make independent athletes, make them stronger on a daily basis. And we work from this holistic athletic model. Probably some of you have seen it. It's made by Professor Willeman and Reins. Professor Willeman is actually the partner who's doing the scientific coordination of the project. And in this model, you look at an athlete from different perspectives. You don't only look at education or the athletic career, but you see it as a complete person. And we also look at, for example, psychological level, sociological level, academic, but also the finances. When an athlete grows up and he develops and he goes to different stages, and you see the stages in every level, you have different transitions. And sometimes the transitions fall all together. And how can you support an athlete going through all these decisions on the different levels? That's what the project is about. And all the sport partners are involved because we want to make it practical so you can actually apply it in the daily practice in, for example, the training centers. The focus of the project is on the athletes between 16 and 25 years old. We also did some research on the age from 12 to 16. It's very young, and most countries involved, they don't have identified talents in this age, so we don't. I don't present the results of that today. We focus on 16 till 25. So what do we do in the project? We have 4 stages in a European project. We call them work packages. First, we look at the competences an athlete needs to go through all these transitions in the holistic perspective. In the second stage, we looked at the dual career service provider. So this is what the abbreviation stands for. So that's actually the people working in training centers, in the schools, career counselors. Every country has a different system for that. The third part is, okay, when we know what competences the athletes need, we know what competences the support providers need, can we think about tools that you can actually use to help the athletes to become better? That's the third stage. And in the end, we want to deliver a best practice guide. The project is like 2 years time. It started last year in January, and it will finish this year in December. So it's not finished yet, but I will give you some results that we have so far. We don't develop new tools in this project because we don't have enough time for that to test it, but it could be a future project. So let's start with the first stage, the athletes' competences. Well, the good things if that you have nine countries involved, we all have athletes in elite sports, you have a pretty big sample. So we sent out questionnaires to 7,500 athletes, and we got a response rate of 43%. More than 3,000 athletes actually filled in the questionnaire, so that's a very big group. And what did we question them about? Well, the people from the sports in the project said we don't want questions to ask questions, we don't to have questions that the athletes can recognize, they have a feeling why we're doing this research for. So we decided to work with dual career situations, we call them scenarios, and we took a list of 38 competences. And the competences, we described the knowledge, skills, attitude, and we asked the people, the athletes, how important do you rate the competences, and do you possess these competences already, or do you need some extra support or help or training to master the competences better? Well, let's have a look at the different scenarios. Well, Susanna was also in the group. I work for Olympic Committee, but there are also actually some dual career service providers in the group who work directly with the athletes, like Susanna. And they just looked at their daily work and they saw, well, where do we see the athletes struggle with? And they came up with seven scenarios. First scenario, you have a challenging year, you have exams, and you also have a strong competition. Well, how do you combine the two? How do you manage? The second, you have to make a study plan. You have to go from secondary education to higher education. You have to choose a study which matches with your program. Well, how do you manage? You miss days of study because of your training. How do you manage as an athlete? Fourth scenario is a relocation scenario. If you have to move from your parents to the training center or to another place to follow your program, how do you deal with it? Are you okay? You need help? What competences do you use? The fifth scenario is what happens when an athlete gets injured. He's far away from home. How does he deal with it? Does he cope? What competences do you need in that scenario? The sixth scenario is social life. We see some of the athletes struggle with their social life. They have very busy schedules, training, studying, and they want to have contact with their friends and their family. How do you cope? And the last is the financial scenario. If you don't have enough money to live away from your parents, to pay for your study, to pay for your training program, how do you cope? You see, we chose the scenarios a bit along the holistic view, so you see all the different levels coming back in this scenarios. So what did the athletes answer? They actually said missing days of study was the most challenging for them. They could use some extra help there. And the social life, they were really struggling with missing out on their social life. We also asked them, okay, what competences, we had this list of 38 competences, do you think are most important for you as an athlete? And this is what they filled in the questionnaire. Perseverance during challenging times, most important of all competences. Well, there are some statistical numbers. We are very happy that there are a lot of very smart scientists in the group who do all the statistical analysis. But the highest number is basically that most athletes filled this in as a number one. The second one is understanding the importance of rest and recuperation. And the third one, ability to cope with stress in sports and study. So these three are the most important competences the athlete thought they needed to have. The other question was, what competences do you think you possess already? And this was an interesting list. They said they were very good at making social contacts with peers. They're very good at making sacrifices, making choices for their study, for their sports. And the third part was ability to live independently with competent life skills. I thought especially this last one was quite interesting because they're young athletes and they already think they're very independent, but that's in their own eyes, of course. We did the 38 competences we had, and we said, okay, it's a bit hard to analyze all the 38. Let's make a group of competences and see where the athlete needs to improve. And we call it, in statistical terms, you call this a factor analysis. We have five groups of competences. And in these groups of competences, we thought, okay, what was most important? And what was the possession of the athlete? And if the athlete thought it was really important, but there was a gap between how much they thought they possessed the competence, that means they need to improve, they need extra support on these competences. So if you look at the list, the basic conclusion is that the athlete needs most help with their mind and emotion management and their life management. So more the softer skills. The two on the bottom, the athletes think they have enough support and they're competent enough to deal with themselves. It's about networking, about career planning. I think if you look for the Dutch situation, a lot of support is already provided on career planning and networking. And we're also looking for a system how to work to make independent athletes with a top sport lifestyle. So this was interesting conclusion. Well, we had a symposium in Amsterdam about work package one and all the results. It lasted a day, so I can do a few highlights. If you want to know more about this research, just ask me later on in the conference. We go now to the second part. We did it the first half year of this year. The competences that dual career service providers need to help the athletes, to make them stronger, to support them. We just finished this this part of the project, so it's really fresh. We haven't presented it to other audiences, so you're the first persons. We use the same system, also the situations, the critical situations, the scenarios, and a list of competences, and we ask them, okay, how important do you think they are, and do you possess these competences? So how many dual career service providers answered? It's a group of more than 300 people, and they work in the training centers, schools, federations, very diverse, and from all the different countries involved. If you look at the service providers, their mean age was like 44 years old, so they're very experienced in life. And what was remarkable is that only 29% of them were working full-time. So most of them are part-time. They're teachers in the school, and they help the athletes on the side, or they were part-time in training centers. So no full-time jobs, and all from very different backgrounds. In all the countries, they're most part-timers, only in Poland. But in Poland, they're just setting up the dual career system, and they only had a few persons who filled in the questionnaire, so that gives a bit of a not a complete view. So what are the scenarios we looked at with the experts, the dual career experts? They're a bit similar, but also a bit different to what we asked the different athletes. The first one is a scenario in which you want to help the coach, help the athlete manage their education, and then you have somebody in the environment of the athlete who is not supportive. It can be a coach, it can be an expert, it can be a manager or a parent, and they don't stimulate the athlete to follow their education. How do you manage? The second is also the relocation scenario, when you have to help an athlete who goes to live away from home for their athletic career? How do you support them? The third scenario is about the study plan. How do you help an athlete with making the right choice of study combined with the combined with their athletic career? This is a similar scenario as which we asked the athletes. The fourth scenario is a challenging year, a competition, a lot of exams. How do you help the athlete to manage? The fifth scenario is if you have an athlete who has a problem and has to go to a psychologist or he needs financial advice, how do you refer to the right expert? And the last scenario is when you do a career support provider and you want to help an athlete, and an athlete thinks you will do all the work for him and go to his teachers and help him, and there's a mismatch in expectations. How do you handle that as a person, as a provider? But all these scenarios is the same with the athletic scenarios. We chose them with the dual career service providers themselves from their own experience, and they were all experienced quite often. I was very happy that this first scenario wasn't experienced as often as we expected. So most coaches are actually promoting a dual career now as well. The third and the fourth scenario are most frequently experienced. And that is that they need help with their study plan, and the other one is missing classes. So they were the most frequently, and number three and five are best managed. So what do the support providers think they can manage the best? They think they're okay, they're competent enough to help with the study plan, and on the other hand, they think they know have enough knowledge to refer to the right expert. So they don't need help on that. Well, this is a bit a technical term, a transferable competence. What we did is on the list of 38 competences and all the scenarios, we actually checked how often the providers, the support providers, actually filled in each competence. And there are some competences that they filled in the most throughout all the six scenarios. You can do an analyze on scenario one, scenario two, three, four separately, but we did it all in total. And these are the answers. So the support providers, they think it's most important to stimulate autonomy, independent athletes, treat them in an individualized manner. So no standard instruments. And have a look in a holistic perspective. So holistic view of the athlete. So these three are most important to them. And it actually shows it was a good choice for us to choose the holistic model as a base for this project. But this is a slide. It's the same slide as we did with the... it's a lot of data for you, I guess, but I hope you can follow it. It shows the difference again, just like we just did with the athletes. How important do you think a competence is for you as a service provider? And how do you think you possess it? And how big is the gap? So where can you learn? Where can you improve? And these are the five that are mentioned the most. It looks like the service providers need some help or training to help the athletes through these different transitions. They need help to stimulate their autonomy. With the competence where they need knowledge, they need to refer to an expert, or they need to know, help them with the planning, it's okay. But if you look at the softer competences, they can use some extra training and understanding the key transitions of phases of dual career and the LTAD model. So if you look at the groups, so it's a mere, it's more on a little more abstract level. What can you say? The dual career providers need help with empowerment competences and supporting the athlete well-being. And they're okay, they're competent enough with communication. They have very wide range of communication skills and help the athletes with organization, planning. They're fine with that. So there's a gap on this part of the competences throughout Europe. Some other results. Well, it was a very diverse sample. people from training centers, from schools, federations. No training programs all over Europe, only 50% had a specific training. Communication skills are very important according to the dual career service providers. Competences needed to empower, and full-time dual career service providers are more confident in their daily job than the part-timers. So what I'm trying to do from Olympic Committee perspective is, okay, what can we do with this? Can we focus on more full-timers? Can we help the, our own service providers with empowerment competences? Can we give them training in the future? Things like that. Well, the third and the fourth stage, we're actually in the middle of it. Third stage, we did some focus groups, interviews with the different experts. And we asked them, what methods do you use and do you feel the methods are successful? And you see there are not many standard methods. They want to treat the athlete in an individual way. They have tools for intakes, they have formats how to have a conversation, how to manage expectations, a monitoring, evaluation, but methods to work on empowerment, they're not available yet. And in the end, we want to have the best practice guide. One last slide with data, and then I will finish. I thought it was interesting because we are here working in a sports perspective, and a lot of these dual career service providers, including in this sample, are also working for education. The results on European level are not done yet to compare the education with the sports part, but this is some of the Dutch results. And what you see here is actually differences between what they think they need to have and what they possess. And it's funny that the people who work in sports, so they work in the regional training center or in the CTOs, they actually also say we need help on empowerment and self-management, but they also say we have a lack of knowledge of the educational system. Can you help us with that? And the people in the education part, they say, yeah, we don't know how we can help the athletes with their athletic planning and their athletic life because we have a lack of knowledge there. So it looks like we need to combine the two worlds more together. And I do feel the sports people feel confident in planning and coordinating different events. And the education people, they think they have very good interview skills. They're all very high educated. I will conclude with an invitation. This is just in between results, but our final conference, it will last the entire day about this project. It's on the 8th of December. It's in Brussels, probably at the Free University or the European Union. So if you are interested by this project and you want to know more, please be welcome. There's also some other research done on dual career throughout Europe. This is more about the structures we have in the different European countries. Also interesting report, it's done by an Amsterdam university. Have a look at it when you have time, and have a look at these websites if you want to know more about the GIES project or more results, because this was just a few highlights. Thank you.
Yes, thanks for the presentation. It was very interesting. I'd just like to ask, how is this connected, if in any way, to the European Athlete Student Network?
The European Athlete Student Network? Well, I think the INSEP is also in the board of the EAS, and so we also do dissemination through the European Athlete Student Network. So in that case, yeah, that's the connection. Some people are involved in both networks, and when we have the outcomes, we share.
Okay, so well connected.
Yeah, yeah. Any more questions? Yeah.
okay, this is a preliminary analysis. What do you think could be a solution or potential solution to this gap between the educational model and the dual career athletes situation?
Yeah, we're discussing that in this group of experts and what will be our next steps. And because this is just stage 3 and 4, we do an inventorization of all the instruments that are available now, but we see there are instruments missing. So a solution could be to develop tools and to develop a training program, perhaps on a European level, and that you can roll out on your specific countries. Yeah, because what we also see in the project that every country has a different system, a different situation, so you can't really do a European training. You also have to translate to your own context, but yeah, that could be a solution.
Will you dovetail this program in with the IOC, or are there going to be two different parallel tracks? Will they, obviously you've shared your information, will they look at your information and hopefully help some developing as they work with their separate provider to dovetail some of your knowledge and learnings into the IOC athlete gateway?
Yeah, well, I just arrived, so I know somebody presented from the IOC. I don't know if they are gone, but they contacted me. Oh, she's right there. Well, yeah, well, I got a message from the IOC last week if we could contact and combine the outcomes, and yeah, it would be nice to talk about that later on.
Thank you very much, Ingrid.
Thank you.
Welcome. Now Tapio will explain the Finnish dual career program.
Yeah, it was good. Thanks.
Huh? The microphone.
Oh.